Hello everyone, welcome to getlectures.com. Today we are going to discuss about the DSSSB PGT Computer Science. So recently Directorate of Education, Delhi, have released a notification for TGT Computer Science postgraduate teachers in computer science. So this job is about teaching in government schools of Delhi. And you will be teaching computer science to 11th and 12th students. So if you have done BTech, if you have done BTech and MTech, or you have done MCA or MSc computer science, so this is a very good chance for you to work in Delhi in government schools. So if you are in teaching, if your interest is in teaching, so you can apply for this post. And they have released various posts for various subjects, for example art, science, commerce. So in this video we are going to discuss only about computer science. So I'm going to discuss the notification which they have released, what are the posts and how many posts are there for general, OBC, SCST and PH. And what is the selection criteria, what will be the pattern of the examination, what is the age criteria, all these things we are going to discuss in this video. So what we are going to do is, we are going to start a new video series for DSSSB. In this video series, we will discuss the previous year questions of DSSSB. So these videos will help you to prepare for this exam. And so any exam, for example, if you are preparing for any exam, the practice is most important thing. So what we are going to do is, we are going to help you in practice the questions. Daily we are going to upload 30 previous year questions and solution of these. So if you watch one video daily for 2 months, you will be able to prepare for this exam very well. So every video will be in Hindi and English. So in this video we will start with discussing the notification. So Directorate of Directorate of Education and NCT Delhi, okay, Delhi government have released a notification for DSSSB in which they have released vacancies for PGT in computer science, okay, postgraduate teacher in computer science for male. They have released, okay, we have already discussed all these things in Hindi. So this video is for those who are not able to understand Hindi and want video in English. So we have received a lot of requests that our video should be in English also. So this video is in English. PGT computer science male for unreserved OBC, SC, ST and PH. They have released vacancies. For example, in unreserved 51 vacancies are available, in OBC 26 vacancies are available, 14 SC, ST 4, 7 and 98 in PH. And PGT computer science for female, there are vacancies 51 in unreserved, which means general category, OBC 26, 15 SC, 7 ST and 99 in PH. So these are the vacancies. You can fill this form. Last date to fill this form is, only 2 days are left. 31st January 2018 is the last date to fill this form till 5 PM. And this is the Group B job. This is a very good job, Group B job, in which we have a grade pay of 4800, which means your salary will be around 80,000 per month. And this job is actually very good job. You have to work only for 4 hours per day and your salary is 80,000 and it's a government job. So this is a good job if you want to work in teaching field and if you have done MTech and or MC or MSc. So age criteria is 30 years and the exam pattern is like this. So they have two kind of exams, tier 1 tier exams and 2 tier exams. And different tiers of exams are there for different subjects. For example, for computer science there will be only one tier exam, okay. One tier exam means there will be a single paper in which you will have two sections, okay, section A and section B. So there will be two sections and paper B only will be one. But in two tier exam there will be two tiers. One tier will be technical, non-technical, and second tier will be subjective paper. That will be for other subjects, for example art, science, art, commerce or language courses. For all those courses there are two tier exams. For we are concerned only about computer science. So in computer science there will be a single paper in which we will have two sections, section A and section B. Section A will be of 100 questions, which means 100 marks. And the section in this section A will be, there will be 5 sections in this. For example, general awareness. First section will be general awareness. Then there will be a second section, which will be from general intelligence and reasoning. Then aptitude, obviously. And fourth section will be English comprehension. And fifth section will be of Hindi comprehension. This is important. You have to prepare for Hindi comprehension also. In normal examination, they do not ask Hindi, but in this examination, they are asking about Hindi. You have to prepare complete grammar, vyakaran of Hindi, all these things. So Hindi and English also section. There are 100 questions, 100 marks, 20 questions from each section, 20 questions from general awareness, 20 questions from reasoning, 20 questions from aptitude, 20 questions from English and 20 questions from Hindi. So there will be total 100 questions in first section, and in section B there will be 200 questions, which means 200 marks. Okay. So complete paper will be of 300 marks, 200 marks, and this paper will be completely technical paper, in which they will ask the technical subjects or computer science. Okay. For example, there will be questions from C, data structure, algorithms, database management system, computer architecture, operating system, C, and all these subjects will be included in this paper. And technical paper, you will see, we will discuss the solutions of previous paper. You will see that there are very simple questions in this technical part. Okay, very simple questions compared to UGC NET or GATE. If you have prepared for UGC NET and GATE, there will be very simple questions for you. The questions will be like this. For full form, they will be asking the full form of something, they will be asking about the protocols, all these things. Okay, we will discuss the paper, you will have idea what kind of questions they ask. So if you watch our video daily, on the daily basis, from this channel, from our channel, that is DJ Mentor Educations, you will be able to prepare the paper thoroughly. So there will be 200 questions from technical, and these questions will be from technical subjects or computer science, plus there will be a section of teaching aptitude as well. Okay, teaching aptitude is also asked in UGC NET. So teaching aptitude part and technical part, there will be only 10 to 15 questions on teaching aptitude, but on more. So let's discuss what is essential qualification for this post. Essential means this is required. Okay, essential qualification, at least you should be qualified according to this essential qualification. There are three categories for essential qualification. If you have done B or BTech in computer science, then you can also apply. But the condition is you have done 1 year diploma in computer science. Okay, that is PGTCA, postgraduate diploma in computer application. If you have done BTech plus PGTCA from DOC, plus you have 1 year experience in teaching, then you can apply. Second, if you have done MSc in computer science or you have done MCA, then you can also apply, plus but you should have 1 year experience in teaching. Okay, one year experience in teaching required for MCA and MSc and for BTech. But if you are MTech in computer science, this is a very good chance for you. If you have passed out your MTech, or let's say if you will complete your BTech and you are MTech in 2018 July, then you cannot apply. But if you have already completed your MTech in 2017, then you can apply. And for MTech students, no experience is required, they can directly apply. Okay, if you are MTech computer science, this is a very good chance for you. So let's discuss the paper. We have discussed all these things. What is this notification? So let's discuss what are the questions. So what we will do is, daily we will upload 30 question solutions of your DSSB. You can watch those solutions and can prepare well for this exam. Okay, exam is expected to be in March, so you have 2 months to prepare. In these 2 months, you can prepare at least 8 subjects or computer science, and 8 subjects are enough. Okay, plus you have to prepare for non-technical part also. For non-technical part, you can visit various websites and you can read for general awareness, you can read the current affairs, and you can simply prepare reasoning, aptitude, English and Hindi. Okay, remember, you have to prepare Hindi also in non-technical part. So non-technical part will take at least 15 days to prepare, and technical part, if you have already prepared for UGC NET or GATE, then you do not need to prepare for those subjects. What you can do is you can simply watch our videos, which we will be uploading on daily basis, and that will help you to prepare. So question one from the last year paper of DSSB computer science PGT. This question is saying, fragmentation is what? Fragmentation is a word. Okay, this question is from operating system. First thing, And in operating system, we fragment the memory in equal size partitions or various, or let's say, sometimes in unequal size partitions. You have read paging and segmentation. In paging, what we do is we divide the virtual memory into pages and we divide the main memory into frames. Okay, that is called as fragmentation. When we are dividing main memory into frames, that is called fragmentation. So paging and segmentation are the techniques of fragmentation of memory. So if you are using paging, then what you are doing is you are dividing the memory into equal sized frames. If you are using segmentation, then you are dividing the memory into segments. So option A is saying dividing the secondary memory into equal sized fragments. Option B is saying dividing the main memory into equal sized fragments, fragment of memory words used in the page, fragment of memory words unused in a page. Option B is the correct answer, dividing the main memory into equal size fragments. Okay, this is the definition of fragmentation. So B is the right answer for this question. Question number 2, mutual exclusion problem occurs in what kind of processes? Okay, these are the four options and we have to select one. Mutual exclusion is a problem. Okay, you have heard about the mutual exclusion. Mutual exclusion means only one process can access a resource at a one time. If you have a shared resource, for example, let's say you have any resource, printer or let's say memory or CPU, these are the resources in computer system, or files or variables, all these are the resources. And let's say two processes, P1 and P2, want to access the same data. Okay, let's say for example you have a global variable. Global variable can be accessed for all the process. Okay, all the processes can access this global variable. So mutual exclusion says only one process is allowed to access this resource at one time. Okay, two processes cannot access this resource simultaneously. This is the problem of mutual exclusion. And you have heard this about this word in process synchronization, in deadlock. Okay, so problem occurs in between. This mutual exclusion actually occurs when you have cooperating processes. Cooperating processes means the execution of one process depends on the other. Okay, when you have dependent processes also known as cooperating processes. So in system we have only two kind of processes, that is cooperating processes and independent processes. When you have cooperating processes, on those cooperating processes, the problem of mutual exclusion occurs. So A is saying between two decision processes that do not intersect. That do not intersect means they are independent processes. Okay, do not intersect means disjoint simply means P1 intersection P2 equals to 5, which means they do not have any common thing. This is disjoint. So actually as we have discussed, mutual exclusion occurred in the cooperating processes. So option is false. Among processes that share the resources, this is true. Whenever any number of processes sharing the same resource, then there will be the problem of mutual exclusion, or they are called as cooperating processes. Whenever any number of processes sharing the same data item, they are known as cooperating processes, because the execution of one process will depend on the other process. Why? Because let's say process P1 want to access the data item R1. For example, let's say this is P1, this is P2, and we have two resources R1 and R2. Okay, let's say these are the resources. If I draw the resource allocation graph, let's say P1 is requesting for R1 and R2 is allocated to P1 and P2 is waiting for R2 and R1 is already allocated to P2. Here what is happening is they are the shared resources R1 and R2. P1 is also using these resources and P2 is also using these resources. So P1 is holding R2 and waiting for R1. P2 is holding R2. P2 is holding R1 and waiting for R2. So what is happening is now neither process P1 can proceed because P1 is waiting for P2 to free up the R2, and P2 is waiting for P1 to free up the R2. So like this, each process is waiting on each other due to these shared resources. That's why there is a problem of mutual exclusion. Deadlock says there should not be mutual exclusion on the processes. All the processes should be able to access the data item simultaneously. So B is the right answer. C is saying among processes that do not use the same resources. This is saying the opposite of B, which is false. So option B is the correct answer for this question. Question number 3, match list 1 with the list 2. Select the correct answer using the codes. So we have some terms on list 1 and some algorithms on list 2. We know that round robin is a process scheduling algorithm which is used in time sharing systems. Time sharing means processes, multiple processes are running in the CPU and they are switching between each other. Okay, we know that CPU can execute only one process at a time if you have a single processor system. But what we are saying is we are actually executing multiple processes at the same time. Okay, user thinks that all the processes are running simultaneously, but in this system, in time sharing systems, for example, Windows operating systems, Windows operating system is a time sharing system in which we are using round robin algorithm. Round robin algorithm give chance to every process after some amount of time. Okay, that's why round robin algorithms are used in time sharing systems. And scan is a disk scheduling algorithm. We know that C scan, C look, all these are the disk scheduling algorithms. Disk scheduling algorithms means whenever lot of requests are coming to access the hard disk for track numbers, what we do is we use the disk scheduling algorithms, and this disk scheduling algorithm decide which process should be responded first. LIFO and FIFO are two different algorithms. Disk scheduling is matching with two, that is scan. Scan is a disk scheduling algorithm. Then time sharing, we know that is matching with round robin. What you can do is if you know only these two things, you can find the options. A is matching with 2 and C is matching with 1. So A is matching with 2 and C is matching with 1. So obviously C is the right answer. But we know that in batch operating system, what happens is whenever any process comes, that process is scheduled first. Okay, in batch operating systems, what we have a batch of jobs. Okay, let's say this is main memory in which we have jobs. Batch operating system were the first operating systems which were designed. In these batch operating systems, what happen is this is CPU. One process from RAM is selected to execute. This process will be executing this on CPU. Then this process will go for IO operations. So now when J1 is doing the IO operation, CPU is free, which means you can schedule another process. Okay, logically, but batch operating system does not allow this. What batch operating system says is first this process will be completed first, and then only J2 can be scheduled. So in this case, in batch operating systems, CPU is idle most of the times. Batch operating system is matching with FIFO, then interrupt is matching with LIFO, last in first out. So according to this, option C is the correct answer, correct matching, A2, B4, C1, D3. Fourth question is, bootstrap loader is always stored in which kind of memory? Okay, so we have these four kind of memories, cache, ROM, RAM, disk. In which of these memory bootstrap is stored? So first we should know what is bootstrap. Bootstrap is a program stored in ROM. Whenever you power on your computer system, what happens is when you power on your system, the power goes to BIOS, and BIOS, in this BIOS we have a program that is bootstrap loader. This program starts executing, and what this program does is bootstrap loader loads the operating system from hard disk to main memory. Then operating system is being executed. So as you know that when you power on your system, there's a processing going on. That processing means hard operating system is being loaded from hard disk to main memory, and this thing is done by bootstrap loader. Okay, bootstrap loader is always stored in the ROM. So B is the right answer for this question. Next question is from CPU scheduling. The jobs are assumed to have arrived at time 0, which means arrival time of all the processes is 0. In that order, PQRST, calculate the departure time. Departure time simply means completion time. Okay, departure time means when they depart from the CPU, completion time. We have to find the completion time of P if scheduling is round robin with time slice 1. So we have to use round robin algorithm with time quantum equals to 1. Okay, which means each process will be executed only for 1 unit time. So let's draw the Gantt chart for this. So Gantt chart will be like this. Arrival time of all the processes is 0. So P come first at 0, and P is executed for 1 time unit, that is from 0 to 1. Then 1 to 2 Q is executed, and Q completes because Q requires only 1 time unit. Then from 2 to 3 R is executed, which means they have executed for 1 time unit. Now they require only 3 and 7. Then S will come, 3 to 4, S will run, and this is completed. Okay, has been completed, then T will come 4 to 5 and we have only left with 1 time unit 4T. Now P again comes and this runs from 5 to 6, then Q is completed. So now R comes from 7 to 6 to 7, which means 6 time units more required. Then T comes 7 to 8 and T is completed. Now we have only two processes, that is P and R. So P require only 2 seconds now, because P have completely run for 1 second here and 1 second here. So P already run for 2 time units, it requires now 2 time units more. Then P comes 8 to 9. Okay, now only one process left, that is R. R comes from 9 to 10. Then again P comes from 10 to 11. So now P is completed, because we have run for 2 time units here, 3 and 4. So P completes at 11. This is the completion time of P1, which they are asking. Completion time of P is 11. This is very simple question. So these simple questions will be asked in DSSSB. Then question number 6. Suppose we have a system in which processes is in hold and wait condition, then which of the following approach prevent the deadlock? That they are asking about the prevention, deadlock prevention. So deadlock prevention says we have four necessary conditions for deadlock. And what are those four necessary conditions? Which means to occur the deadlock, necessary means to say that a system is in deadlock, there should be four conditions which are satisfying. One is there should be mutual exclusion between processes. Second condition is each process should be holding one resource and waiting for another resource, which means hold and wait. Third condition is processes should be in the circular wait. If processes are waiting for each other in cycle, then there's a circular wait. Fourth is starvation. Okay, these are the four necessary conditions for deadlock. If these four conditions occur simultaneously, then definitely there's a deadlock. So in deadlock prevention, what we do is we try to prevent at least one condition. Okay, what we do is if you are able to provide no mutual exclusion, then there's no deadlock. If you are able to provide no hold and wait, then no deadlock. Four necessary conditions, if you are able to prevent at least one condition, then there is no deadlock. So A is saying request all resources initially. What will happen if you request all the resources initially? In this case, what will happen is, let's say P1 requires some resources, let's say R1, R2, R3. P1 requires all these resources to execute. So the option is saying request all the resources initially. If P request all these resources initially and P gets all the resources, then P will start executing. Okay, P1 will start executing and it will not request any resource in the while it is executing. Okay, this is like static approach. Static approach how? If any process requires any number of resources, it will request before starting the execution. If you take all the resources before starting the execution, this means that there cannot be hold and wait, which means you are preventing this condition. This condition cannot be there. If this is the approach for prevention, request all resources initially. If P gets all the resources, then P will start executing. If P cannot get at least one resource, then it will leave all the resources. So option A is correct. This will prevent the hold and wait. And as I said, if you are able to prevent at least one condition, that there's no deadlock. P saying spool everything. Spool everything means you have to put all the requests in the queue. Okay, if you spool everything, then what will happen is there will be starvation. Take resources away, which means if you are let's say P1 is holding one resource, that is R1. P1 is holding R1 and P1 is requesting R2. Okay, R1 is already assigned to P1 and P1 is requesting for R2, which means hold and wait condition. So this C option is saying if some process is requesting any resource and if this process cannot get this resource, then what we need to do is take all the resources which it is holding already. Take all the resources away from this. You can snatch all the resources from P1 if P1 cannot get a resource which it is requesting. In this case, what will happen is there will be starvation. Okay, So C cannot be the answer, B cannot be the answer. Order resources numerically. Okay, if you order the resources numerically, what will happen is only ordering the resources is not enough. What you need to do is every process should request the resources in a proper order, either in increasing order or in decreasing order. You can easily number the resources, let's say R1, R2, R3, R4, but you have to request the resources in some order, for example increasing order or decreasing order. In that case, circular weight cannot be there. But this is not enough, ordering is not enough. After ordering, process should request the resources in some order. Okay, option is the right answer for this question. Next question is, disk scheduling involves deciding what? What is the main purpose for having disk scheduling algorithms? Disk scheduling algorithm decides which request for the disk should be served first. Okay, let's say for example, CPU is sending the request like this 20, 30, 12, 18, 16, 19. So these are the track numbers which CPU want to access. Then in this case, what will happen is CPU will run the disk scheduling algorithm, and disk scheduling algorithm will decide which request should be served first. For example, if you are using first come first serve disk scheduling algorithm, then 20 will be served first, then 30, then 12, then 18, then 16, then 19. If you are using shortest seek time first, that is SSTF, then what will happen is it will let's say initially the head is at 20, let's say 10. So disk scheduling algorithm will choose the request which is nearer to 10. For example, 12 is the most nearer to 10. So it will serve the request 12. So what is the purpose of disk scheduling algorithm is to minimize the seek time and minimize the head movement. We want to minimize the head movement and we want to minimize the seek time. This is the main purpose of disk scheduling algorithm. So disk scheduling algorithm decides which request should be served first. Option A is saying which disk should be accessed first. Okay, no, it is, we are not talking about disk, we are talking about disk tracks. The order in which disk access request must be serviced, this is the right answer. The physical location where files should be accessed in the disk, this is obviously wrong. So B is the right answer for this question. Question number 8 is saying, in route robbing CPU scheduling, as the time quantum is increased, the average turnaround time, what is the effect on average turnaround time if we increase the time quantum? Okay, in such type of questions, what you can do is you can simply take a small example. Let's say we have some processes and we have some arrival time and burst time. Let's say we have two processes P1 and P2. Arrival time of these two processes is 0 and burst time is, let's say, 6 and 4. I'm taking round robin algorithm and time quantum 2. So what will be the effect on the turnaround time if I take time quantum 2 and then I increase the time quantum to 4. So with 2, the processes will be run like this. Initially P1 will run from 0 to 2, then P2 will run from 2 to 4, then P1 will run from 4 to 6, and then P2 will run from 6 to 8. P2 completes, P2 has executed for 2 and 2, 4 time units, and 4 time units were required. Then 8 to 10, P1 will run. So P1 is also completed. Now let's find out the turnaround time. Turnaround time for P1 is turnaround time simply means completion time minus arrival time. Okay, the time which this process spent in the system. So completion time is 10 and arrival time is 0. And turnaround time of P2 is 8 minus 0, that is 8. So average turnaround time becomes 10 plus 8 by 2, that is 9. Okay, if I increase the time quantum to 4, let's say I increase the time quantum to 4, then what will happen? In this case, your Gantt chart will be like this. P1 will run from 0 to 4, then P2 will run from 4 to 8. And P2 completes, okay, then P1 runs from 8 to 10 because P1 requires only 6 nanoseconds, 4 already run and 2 more required, which we are giving here. So for P1 turnaround time is 8 minus 0. Okay, that will be 8. And P2 equals to 10 minus 0, that is 10. So in this case, average turnaround time is same. That is 18 by 2, that is 9. Okay, so average turnaround time is still same. So what you can say is remains constant. C is the right answer for this question. Question number 9 says, which of the following algorithms favor CPU bound processes? What we mean by CPU bound processes? Okay. So processes are only of two types. Whenever a process comes into system, it can be CPU bound process or it can be IO bound process. Okay, process can only be of two types, IO bound and CPU bound, on the basis of the time they spend on CPU and IO. Okay, if a process requires more time on CPU and less time on IO, then we can call the process is CPU bound. If process want to spend more time on IO and less time on CPU, then you can say it is IO bound processes. Okay, so any process which execute will first execute some instructions on CPU, then it will execute some instructions on IO, it will do some IO operations, then it will do some operations on CPU, and then again IO. So any process which come into system will use only two resources, that is CPU and IO, and it will be stored in main memory. So all these three resources will be used by every process. If a process is spending more time on CPU and less time on IO, then it is CPU bound. Okay, if a process is executing on IO for most of the time, then it will be IO bound process. For example, let's say I have these processes P1, P2, P3, and then we have CPU bound process and IO bound process. CPU bus time, okay, sorry, this is CPU bus time and IO bus time. Okay, so CPU burst and IO burst, which means the time which process P1 requires on CPU and on IO. So CPU requires 20, 30, 40, and it requires 40, 20, 30. So which of the process are CPU bound and which of the process are IO bound? For example, this P1 is IO bound process because it requires more time on IO. P2 is CPU bound process because it requires more time on the CPU. This is CPU bound process. Okay, so the question is asking which of these scheduling algorithms favor the CPU bound processes: round robin, first come first serve, or multi-level feedback queues. If you have those process if you have any kind of process, first come first serve does not differentiate between CPU and IO bound processes. So it will take all the processes in the same way because it will execute all those processes which come first. Okay, so this cannot be the answer. Round robin will favor the CPU bound processes. Okay, this will favor the CPU bound processes. If you have processes which will spend more time on CPU, then it will round robin algorithm will decrease the response time of these processes. So like this, multi-level queue feedback will also decrease the average waiting time and average response time, because in multi-level feedback queue what we have is we have multiple queues, and in each queue we are increasing the time quantum time, and finally in the last queue we have first in first out algorithm used. So we have different queues in multi-level queue feedback, and each queue we are using different kind of CPU scheduling algorithms. So round robin and multi-level queue feedback, these two algorithms favor the CPU bound processes, which means 1 and 3 is the right answer. Question number 10 says, spooling helps because, what is spooling? You have heard this word in printers. In printer we have spooler directory, in which whenever you want to print something, let's say you want to print 5 files, file 1, file 2, file 3, file 4 and file 5. What will happen is whenever you give print command, this file will be added to spooler directory. Okay, so whenever a new file comes, this will be added into spooler directory like this. So all these files are waiting to be printed by the printer. So printer, it is like a buffer. Spooler directory is a buffer in the printer. So whenever you want to print anything, this will go to the buffer of printer and printer will pick one file at a time from the spooler directory and will print it. So it is like a producer and consumer. Producer is your CPU is producing the files to be printed in the buffer and printer is consuming the files from the buffer. Okay, so we have a printer and spooler problem also in the process synchronization. This is the same problem. Spooling simply means, if you see the full form of spooling, that is simultaneous. Peripheral operations online. So this is the full form of spooling, simultaneous peripheral operations on online. So spooler is a program which helps to synchronize the operation between slow peripheral and CPU. As you know that CPU is a very fast electronic device and IO operations, or you can say peripherals, are slow devices. So spooling helps to synchronize between operations of IO and CPU. So in this case, what happens is whenever CPU gives any job to IO, IO will execute the job and then CPU can proceed to other tasks. So like this spooler program helps to synchronize operations between CPU and IO. So A is saying it is a more secure method of accessing the data. No, print job goes. Print job goes more smoothly with less stop and go. C is saying the computer is lazy to do another things while still printing. This is true. Okay, what you can do is while a process is using IO, that is printer, CPU can execute another process simultaneously. Okay, if you have spooler directory will help you to hold the job which is given by CPU, then CPU can proceed to other tasks. C is the right answer for this question. Question 11 says, when a computer is swapping, it is moving data from, let's say, what is swapping? What is the meaning of this word? So you have a hard disk. Okay, let's say this is your hard disk. And this is your RAM. Whenever you want to send some page into main memory, that is known as from main memory to hard disk. If you are sending some page from main memory to hard disk, let's say there's some new process is coming to RAM and you have to replace some pages. So what you need to do is you need to send those pages to disk. This is known as disk swap out. And whenever you want to load some data from hard disk to main memory, this is known as swap in. So whenever you are sending any data from hard disk to RAM, that is known as swap in. And whenever you are sending some data from RAM to hard disk, that is known as swap out. Okay. So swapping is done between hard disk and RAM. Let's say there's a page fault. In case of page fault, what happens is data is not found in the main memory. So in this case, you have to load the data from hard disk to main memory. That is known as swap in. Whenever you need to replace any page, you have to send this page into hard disk. That is known as swap out. So as you have heard about the swap space is a part of hard disk which is used as virtual memory. Okay, so we know that virtual memory is a part of hard disk. This is known as also swap space. So swapping is done in this virtual memory. Okay, in this part of hard disk. So moving data from the hard drive to floppy drive, no. Moving data from main memory to the swap file on the hard drive, this is true. Moving data between register and memory, no. This is known as fetching. Okay. So B is the right answer for this question. Next question says, an interrupt handler is a location in main memory that keeps track of recently generated interrupts, peripheral devices, utility program, or special numeric code that indicates the priority of a request. Interrupt handler, what is interrupt handler? Whenever, let's say you have a CPU. CPU is a master of any computer system. Okay, CPU is a master device. And then you have IO devices. Okay, IO devices are connected to fast interface. IO device 1, IO device 2, all these are connected to interface to translate the operation between CPU and IO, because IO devices directly cannot communicate with CPU because there is difference between the technologies. This is electronic device, these are the electromagnetic devices. Word size of CPU is different, word size of these devices are different. So that's why we have to use interface between CPU and actual devices. So interface interrupt the CPU through the INTR line, and then CPU acknowledge the interrupt through the INTA line. Okay, so whenever there is an interrupt from any device to CPU, CPU will start executing the interrupt service routine. This interrupt can be vectored interrupt or non-vectored interrupt. If it is vectored interrupt, then this device will supply the starting address of the interrupt service routine. If it is non-vectored interrupt, then CPU have to calculate the interrupt address of the device. So for each input output device, we have an interrupt address. Okay, and interrupt handler, or you can simply call interrupt handler, is also known as interrupt service routine. This is a program. Okay, interrupt service routine is a program to handle the interrupts. Whenever there is an interrupt from any device to CPU, CPU starts executing the interrupt service routine to handle the interrupt. So A is saying location in memory that keeps track of recently generated interrupts. No, not a peripheral device, it is a utility program, that is interrupt service routine. So C is the right answer for this question. Then we have these two questions, 13 and 14, which are on scheduling, and the common data for these two questions is this. So these are the processes and bus time. All the processes, consider the following set of processes that arrive at time 0. So all the processes are coming at time 0, which means arrival time for all the processes is 0. With the length of the CPU bus time given in the milliseconds, this is the length of CPU bus time given. What is the average waiting time in millisecond when we use the round robin scheduling algorithm with time quantum equals to 4 milliseconds? So they are asking about the average waiting time in milliseconds. So we are using round robin algorithm with time quantum equals to 4 milliseconds. So let's start executing these processes. Let's draw the Gantt chart, which will help you to calculate the average waiting time. So initially P0 will run from 0 to 4. Okay, so it has run 4. Now P1 will run from 4 to 7, which is completed. P1 is completed. Then P2 will run from 7 to 10. P2 is also completed. Now only one process is left, that is P0. So P0 will run from 10 to 30. Okay, now P0 will run. So what is the waiting time for P1? Waiting time means response time minus arrival time. Response given to process P0 is 0 initially, and the arrival time is also 0. So initially waiting time of P1 is 0, but now P1 again goes to ready queue, which means arrival time of P0 in ready queue is 4 and the response time is 10, which means 10 minus 4 is 6. So waiting time of P1 is 6, waiting time of P2 is 7 minus 0, okay, P1 4 minus 0, that is 4. Waiting time of P3 is, response time of P2 is, okay, this is P1 and this is P2. Waiting time of P2 is response time minus arrival time. Okay, 7 minus 0 is 7. So average waiting time is sum of all the waiting times divided by number of processes. That is 6 plus 4, 10 plus 7, 17 by 3. That is 5.66 milliseconds. So the correct answer for this question is A. Now question number 14 is saying the same algorithm is used, but now they are asking about the average turnaround time. Okay, what is the average turnaround time in milliseconds when we use the round robin scheduling algorithm with the time quantum of 4 milliseconds? So now we have to find out the Gantt chart will be same, because now we have to find out the average turnaround time. So 0 to 4, P0 will run from 0 to 4, then P1 will come 4 to 7. Then P2 will run from 7 to 10, and again 10 to 30, P0 will run. So turnaround time is nothing but completion time minus arrival time. Completion time of P1 is, turnaround time of P0 is completion time minus arrival time, that is 30 minus 0. As we have seen, arrival time of all the processes is 0. Turnaround time of P1 is simply completion time minus arrival time, that is 7 minus 0, 7. Then turnaround time for P2 is, completion time is 10 and arrival time is 0 for all the processes. So average turnaround time is nothing but sum of all the turnaround times divided by number of processes, which is 47 by 3, or you can say 15.66 milliseconds. Option C is the right answer for this question. So last question in this series is 15th question, the Boolean expression A plus B C equals to what? So what you can do is you can try to minimize all these and can find out the equivalent to A plus B C. Let's say I'm trying with the B option. B option is A plus B into A plus C, which can be written as A into A, that is A, plus A into C is AC plus AB plus BC. Or you can say AA is nothing but A according to Boolean algebra laws. So you have to apply the De Morgan laws. You can take common A, 1 plus C plus AB plus BC. So this will become 1. Anything with 1 is 1. Okay, if you take anything with 1, this always will be 1, because this is 1 or something. 1 or something is 1. So A plus AB plus BC. Now you can take A common from here, 1 plus B plus BC, which means this will be A plus BC. So B is the right answer for this question. You can try with all these options, B will be the right answer. So 15th question answer is B. Okay, thanks for watching. Let's meet in the next video.